previous video, I talked about butterfly banks, how creating that variability seems to be really important. What I'd like to do here is talk about other options, including the creation of hollows. I'm here at Wareham in North Norfolk, and over the far side of that hedge, there's an Iron Age hill fort that's famous for being the most northerly site of chalkhill blues in Britain. And 12 years ago, there was a restoration project here, habitat creation project here, where they took some arable fields and then converted them into this wonderful wildflower mix. But then they did some other things as well. So I'm here with Jake Fiennes. What else did they do, Jake?
So we collected species handpicked from a 12-mile radius to ensure that we... There's been bombarded with midges, but we've been bombarded with chalkhill blues on a whole level.
They're all over the place. Yeah, and what's this hollow here?
So as part of the creation of this calcareous chalk grass and meadow, was they wanted to, instead of just using a standard flat field as possible, to try to create lower spots within the field that would be protected from the elements and creating some of the bare chalk, which provides a heat source, which will benefit a whole wide range of species, including bees, but also the ants will benefit, and the butterflies will be able to warm themselves up on cooler days. It's a whole different ecosystem, and then you come out of here, we can actually feel the warmth out of the wind.
Mm. Feels remarkably warmer, doesn't it? And astonishing numbers of chalkhill blue butterflies here.
And the key to the success, so the chalkhill butterflies are exceptionally lazy and don't travel too far. They travel feet as opposed to other butterflies that will migrate for hundreds of miles. So trying to get the site favourable for chalkhill blues was integral to, first of all, having their food plant, and then allowing the site and the soil to develop to be favourable to the ants that they have an association with. The prescriptions when the project started was a cut and remove in mid-July. We changed from a cut and remove in year six to bringing sheep and cattle in, generally in late autumn, for a set period of time till we felt that the vegetation had been reduced sufficiently. What we saw happen over the subsequent years was the butterfly population went from three to thousands. Hmm. The orchid population went from hundreds to tens of thousands. Damn. So we just see the implementation of an agricultural style system that has benefits on biodiversity.
So I don't know if the viewers can see, but there are scores of chalkhill blues flying around here. It is absolutely remarkable. And so, and as you say, it seems to be they're dependent on horseshoe vetch and the ant populations. And
so the horseshoe vetch, which is currently not in flower, those are the seed pods of the horseshoe vetch, which is the food plant for the chalkhill blue. So that's a really important component.
Yep.
And then if you come around here, we can see the ant hills that have been created over time. And if you sit down for long enough, you'll be covered in them.
Yeah.
So a real nature conservation success story.
So I guess the story is that the important thing is to ensure that there's variation in habitats. And we've talked about different ways of doing this. We talked earlier about habitat banks. Here there's creating habitat hollows and how important they are. And then thinking very much about how the management works and making sure that the management of the vegetation is correct in order to have the whole suite of stages for the horseshoe vetch and the ants. And that results in this remarkable, spectacular, large number of chalkhill blues here today.